All right, class. Stay in pairs. One audio guide to a pair. And remember, your best behavior. Tracy, Craig, late again, I see. Well, don't just stand there. You won't see anything that way.
The Art Gallery is very proud to be able to display this extraordinary example of geometric shapes, 86. As seen in George The Three Chirac, Musicians, painted by Sunday Pablo afternoon Picasso on the island of La Grande Jatte. While to the eye these colors seem to blend, you are in fact looking at hundreds of merrymaking. It's a good demonstration of the use of perspective, which helps bring this jolly scene to life. Uses light and shade to give the appearance of depth to the forms in this painting. Not surprising. This first painting is a very special one. Note the artist's use of form, perspective, and color. Don't you think that this painting has a magical quality? A feeling of a fantasy world?
No, don't go away. Keep your eyes on the canvas. Follow the road as it winds its way slowly through the trees. On and on, further and further, until you feel drawn into the very painting itself.
Tracy,
you scared me.
Where are we?
I don't know. This place is weird.
Welcome to Artscape.
I don't understand.
You will, Craig. You see, you and Tracy will soon realize that Artscape is a wondrous world. A world of illusion, a world of light and color, a world where anything can happen. Oh, pardon me, I get so carried away.
How did you know our names?
I know everything, Tracy. I am your guide.
Is this some kind of special tour?
Very special. And very secret.
Is the exit secret, too?
Not if you use your wits, your senses, your talent.
Our what?
Your eyes, ears, and hands. You will discover the exit by having fun, by being creative. In fact, by thinking of art.
Art who?
We do have a lot of work to do, don't we? Still, let us not lose faith so quickly. On with the journey. Just follow the lines.
I don't see any lines.
Oh, come on now. There are lines everywhere. Where would art be without lines? Indeed, where would anything be without lines?
What's happening?
Craig, you know those lines we couldn't see?
Yeah?
They're disappearing.
Yeah, they're disappearing. Look at that. Maybe the lines are mad at us.
I'm beginning to see why lines are so important.
And very sensitive.
Young minds are so willing to learn. Good, let us continue.
What now?
It looks like some vertical lines.
They're moving.
You're right, they're not vertical anymore.
Yeah, they're on an angle.
They're diagonal.
Not anymore. Now they're horizontal. But why?
Look, the lines are pointing to the door. The lines are trying to tell us something.
Don't be stupid. Lines don't talk.
No, but I bet you they were pointing to the way out of here.
They might have been. But here in Artscape, even lines have feelings.
I guess I should have kept my big mouth shut.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Wow, look at all the lines on that tiger.
What did you expect, spots?
Why do you think he's bigger than the trees and the hills?
Well, maybe the artist wanted to show that the tiger rules this jungle. But why did the artist paint the sky like that? All the lines point to the tiger.
That's it.
What?
It's like the lines pointing to the door. The artist is using the lines in the sky
to direct us to the tiger.
Bravo! You see, lines can tell us something. You've used your wit and eyes well. Now, let's move on, shall we?
Craig, come over here.
Now it's time to try out your talents.
Look at this stuff. Charcoal, pastels, and paper on the wall.
Does he want us to draw?
Of course.
What do you want us to draw?
Something with lines.
I can't think of anything with lines.
Then we must do something about your appalling lack of imagination. Look at the lines that nature does possess. Let us see a few of them in nature's wilderness. The lines in a leaf go their separate ways, or scatter and tangle in an intricate maze. The straight solid lines of a vertical tree, or the jagged thick and thin ones of the branches we can see. A spider's fragile web, so delicate and light, yet intricate enough to trap the spider's meal tonight. The diagonal flowing lines of a rushing waterfall is different from the curving lines of grass that's thin and tall. So remember all these different lines, for they'll provide a clue and help you in this world of art to express your point of view. It isn't only nature that provides so many lines, for every manufactured thing has intricate designs. The skyline of a city building standing straight and tall, vertical lines shoot upward and they make us feel so small. The horizontal layers make a warehouse broad and long, majestic sweeping curves in this building do belong. When you create a picture, start with a line or two. Just draw whatever pleases. Let's see what you can do.
Let's draw a tree. That won't be too difficult. And then we can get out of here. Charcoal makes a soft line.
Not if you press hard. See? Strong, hard lines.
Not anymore.
Hey, that's great.
I'm going to try pastels. Hey, it's bumpy here. You can see the bumps of the paper through the pastel.
You're right. It makes the lines on your tree different from mine.
Naturally. Different materials on different surfaces make
different lines.
Very good. You're learning quite a lot about lines. Now, move along to the next area. Look at these lines. Can you tell what the artist is trying to show?
Just some lines.
Tracy!
I mean some curving lines.
Please wait till it's finished.
Look, it's a woman with a hat.
Shh, it's not finished yet.
Oh, yes it is.
You're kidding.
No, I'm not.
I guess the artist wanted us to use our imagination to fill in the rest.
Very clever. You've discovered that many artists use implied line. It's an interesting way of drawing that only suggests the subject. It's going to be a pleasure guiding you through Artscape.
But we-
we can't. We have to get back to the others.
Aren't you enjoying yourselves?
Yes, but Miss Taylor will get mad if she can't find us.
I'm sorry, but your tour is not over yet. We have to follow the programmed route. It's time to move on to movement.
Move on to where?
Right here. Watch carefully and you'll see how lines are used to convey movement. Are you drawing something with movement?
Well, no,
but it's something that moves.
I'm glad that our song was so inspiring. What are you drawing?
A balloon.
Hey, what's happening?
What are you doing?
Hold on, Tracy.
Tracy, Craig, tell me what's going on.
The balloon, it's moving.
That's impossible. This isn't part of the regular Artscape tour.
We're moving along with it.
This has never happened before.
How do we get down from here?
I really don't know.
Now what are we going to do?
Try to get into the basket.
Okay.
Help, I'm falling.
The guard!
This isn't supposed to happen. Look out below!
How delightful and how unexpected. Who are you?
I'm Tracy, and this is Craig.
Very pleased you decided to drop in, so to speak. Osgood J. Pettigrew here, part-time artist and full-time art collector. Now, what can I do for you?
We're trying to find a way out of Artscape and get back to the gallery, but we lost our guide.
No guide, hmm? Well, I've never been a guide before, but it shouldn't be anything that Osgood J. Pettigrew can't handle. There!
Wow, look
at all the mountains.
And their shapes, truly inspiring. It's the triangular shape, you know, that gives a mountain its majestic appearance.
It is?
Yes, that's why I'm up here, shape-watching.
Shape-watching? Is that like bird-watching?
Similar. There, what do you see?
A line.
Hey, look, it's become a square.
Of course. The moment you join lines together, you have a shape. A square is a shape. A geometric shape, to be precise.
We know about geometric shapes from math.
Math. Oh, yes, very handy. But here in Artscape, you must learn to look at shapes with the eyes of an artist. Shapes are such wondrous things. Use them. Study them.
Look, they're making a design.
It looks very rigid.
Yes. When you use only geometric shapes, you get a hard, precise design because of their straight lines and angles.
There's a circle. It's a geometric shape, too, but it doesn't have any angles.
Well, there's always an exception to every rule.
The shapes on the other side aren't geometric. They're all curves, and it looks as though you could squeeze them.
They give you a feeling of floating.
Yes, a wonderful arrangement of organic shapes. But enough. It's time for tea. Welcome to my humble abode.
There must be some way to leave Artscape.
Well, of course there must, but I haven't the foggiest idea what it is. Come along.
Tracy, help!
Craig, what's wrong?
I can't get out.
Don't panic. You've simply trapped yourself inside a shape demonstrator. My own invention. Isn't it wonderful?
But what does it demonstrate?
Why, shape, of course. You see, in art, shape is two-dimensional. It has height and width, but absolutely no depth. That's why Craig looks so flat. Compared to us, he's as flat as a pancake.
I don't want to be a pancake. Let me out.
If you insist, pull on the chain.
Are you all right?
Of course he's all right. He's in perfect shape. This way. This is my music room. Isn't it magnificent?
It's a big room, and I like the fireplace.
Isn't it a little empty? Shouldn't a music room have some musical instruments in it?
Don't get picky. This is Artscape, don't forget. Who needs instruments when one can have paintings of them? Besides, I can't play any of the silly things.
What do these have to do with music?
That one does. Look. Here's a person playing a clarinet. And a guitar. And there's another person holding some sheet music.
That's a famous painting by Pablo Picasso. It's called Three Musicians. Do you like it?
It's a little weird.
Yeah, but isn't it neat the way he's bunched up the straight lines and shapes? And most of his shapes are geometric. See? Look at all the triangles.
And a whole lot of rectangles.
Well,
almost rectangles.
The one over the fireplace, it's very different. It's all curves and organic shapes. But what does it have to do with music?
Because the artist, Joe David, painted the original on a drum.
A real drum? Why?
Just after his father died, he saw a raven beneath a double rainbow. He painted this vision on the drum that was used at his father's memorial ceremony. Fortunately, I was able to obtain this print for my collection. Now, tea time. You, young man, can help me in the kitchen.
What can I do?
You can stare into the fireplace. No, go on. See the flames leaping? An ever-changing pattern of organic shapes. Keep on staring and imagine all the shapes that are around you. And then you may join us for tea. On the shelf, and don't drop them, please. They're very fragile.
There. I'm finished.
Really, Craig, you can make a much more attractive arrangement than that.
I can?
Certainly. Everything on that shelf has an interesting shape. Don't you think they deserve to be arranged artistically?
Sorry. I know. I'll put the tall ones at the back and leave lots of space between everything.
Is that better?
Yeah. And who said that?
Well, if you don't like that arrangement, perhaps you'd like everything much closer together. See? The glasses are touching, but there's still lots of space around everything. Or you could have everything overlapping. That's in case you want depth in your arrangement. But if you don't like that one, I could move everything
That's
again
enough.
And...
Who are you? Are you a ghost?
I don't believe in ghosts.
But you're right there, in that great big space.
But that space is so different from this one, or this one, or this one. Listen.
Spaces are important. Space that you can see.
Tracy, I saw a ghost. It was in the... What are you doing?
It says print room, doesn't it? Well, that's what I'm doing.
But you can't mess up Mr. Pettigrew's floor. He'll be furious.
I don't think he'll mind, as long as it's artistic.
But...
Geometry. Geometric shapes are everywhere. Some are round and some are square. Organic shapes have many curves that seem to flow and curl and swirl.
What was that?
I don't know. Come on.
Thrilling. Absolutely thrilling.
Mr. Pettigrew?
Oh, there you are. Tea will be ready soon.
Did something just blow up?
Voila! I'm experimenting with exploding designs.
How does it work?
The idea is to break up a solid shape the way I've done here so that the spaces help you to create a design. Notice that even these little spaces give one a feeling of movement. I only used a minor charge on this one. I'm about to start another.
Does anything ever go wrong?
Frequently. I lose more rooms this way.
And you are worried about the floor. May we do one?
Why not? But start at the beginning. You have to cut a piece of paper into shapes and then move them outward until you have the design you want. Then I can program it. There, a bit more space. Let's try this one. Ready? Here goes. Oh, excellent. This one has more space and a focal point to attract the eye.
I see it. No matter where you look, you always end up looking at that circle.
Mine's ready. See? I've left even more space. And the shapes are sort of peaceful and floating.
Tricky. But I think we can do it. Here, clip it on. Over there. Now let me see. Ready? Here goes.
Tracy, Craig, help!
That voice. It's our guide.
I'm here.
Where?
Up here. Careful. Thank you. I'm very glad to hear you again. Do you know where we are?
Aren't you supposed to be the guide?
Well, I am, but Artscape's very large, and this is not my usual route.
Let's go in here. Maybe someone will tell us how to get back to the gallery. Wow, I wonder what it is.
What does it look like?
Well, it's a lot of things.
Things? What kind of things?
They're geometric. You know, cubes and cones, and cylinders and things.
Are they in a painting?
No, they're real. I mean, they're really there. You can see all around them.
I see. These things have length and width and depth, do they?
Yes.
Ah, you're looking at forms. Three-dimensional forms.
You can even see the insides. They sort of glow. And they're big, too. They take up a lot of space.
Sounds very impressive.
Yeah, they make me feel very small.
Perhaps we're in the castle of the Baroness Bricabrac. Well, I've been told she's very interested in sculptured forms.
A real Baroness?
What is she like?
Well, I've never met her, but she must be nice. Everyone in Artscape is nice.
Let's go find her.
They can be so useful.
You're right. She does like sculpture. I don't blame her. These are amazing.
Are they geometric forms too?
No, they're mostly organic. All rounded and curved. And they look and feel very solid. They make me think about gentleness and strength at the same time. And they're very heavy. This one's called Dawn. Look, there's a tag that says sold to the Baroness. This one has it too. And that one. Craig!
I am the Baroness Bricabrac, and this is my prized collection of sculptors. And you are trespassing.
We didn't mean to. We're lost. We're not from Artscape.
Not from Artscape.
No, you see, we went to the gallery with Miss Taylor, and we ended up in Artscape by mistake. And now we're trying to find our way out.
So no one knows that you're missing?
No.
Oh, how convenient. Oh, I mean, how tragic. Oh, you poor, dear, sweet little lost things.
We would be very grateful if you could direct us back to my usual route.
Who said that?
Our guide.
Guide? Oh, you don't need a guide in my castle. I'll show you around. What do you think of my collection?
It's wonderful.
Oh, of course it's wonderful. And it's only the beginning. There's so much splendid sculpture in the world, and all of it will soon be mine. I adore sculpture. Such magnificent forms. Why, look at this. See how the soapstone, wood, and steel can be made to capture the essence of movement? Each day my collection grows and grows. Soon I will have more and more. And you, you lucky children, you'll be glad to grow old here, surrounded by such beauty. For you, you will be spending the rest of your lives here, serving the Baroness Bricabrac.
What do you mean?
I mean you're never going to leave Artscape. Children? Children, where are you? You're beginning to upset me.
Tracy, run!
And I'm not very pleasant when upset. Oh, you're not going to get away so easily. How clever of you to find your own way here. Now, put those on and sit down.
Madam Baroness, as an official Artscape tour guide, I demand to know what is going on.
Why, it's very simple, Mr. Official Talking Machine. It seems that whenever I leave my castle gates open, these little darlings can't resist trespassing. So, naturally, out of the goodness of my own heart, I'm training them to become great artistes. Very nice. Stop fidgeting. Oh, yes, my new friends. We have only two rules here. No talking and no resting. Now, sit down and create.
But this is wrong. Very wrong. Creativity should be a joyful experience, an expression of an individual, not a force that simply...
What are we gonna do? I don't know.
No talking there.
Sorry,
We were just wondering what happens to all these things.
You really want to know? Work!
If I want to collect all the art in this land, it would cost me much silver and gold. So your work I will sell, for this art's in demand. I'll be rich if you do what you're told. So work hard, little darlings. Keep cutting and folding all day. And the forms that you're making, these wonderful sculptures, do them all in your own different way. In wood or in paper mache, you'll see how I'll make it pay.
We're working, she'll get mad if we do it wrong. She won't ever let us rest, never. We're just working the whole day long.
So work hard.
Other questions?
Yes. If you keep us working all the time, won't we run out of ideas for things to make?
Ideas? Run out of ideas? You silly child. Why, all around you there are geometric and organic forms just waiting to give you ideas. Artists never run out of ideas. Come here. Get up on the stage. Pay attention, children. I'm about to share some of my vast knowledge with you. Now, here we have a form. Length, width, and depth, taking up a great deal of space. Now, do you think that a form like this can convey feelings? Well, you're wrong. Wrong, wrong! Craig, use your form to convey fear.
What?
Feel frightened! There! You see how easy it is. Now, I know. Show exhaustion. Oh, that's wonderful! Happiness!
But he's not happy.
Feel happy or else. Oh, that's pathetic. Sit down. All right. Now we're going to talk about drawing form. You three, into position. Listen carefully now. It's easy for a sculptured form to look as if it has length, width, and depth, because it has length, width, and depth. Ah, but when you're working on a flat surface, you don't have depth, so you must create the illusion of depth.
I wish she were an illusion.
Tracy! Shadows play an important part when creating the illusion of depth. First, the real thing. Stand still now. Watch how the shadows fall as the lights alter.
I can see the shadows. They're in the folds. And when the light changes, the shadows are in different places.
Exactly. Now, Tracy, come here. I want to show you a painting by Ken Danby. Tell me what you see.
Shadows. Lots of shadows. See? Here, here, and in here. And that's because the light's coming from here. The light and the shade make everything look so real. I can almost smell the popcorn.
Oh, you clever child!
Now I'll show you something else.
Now, where did I put that? Ah, here it is. Now, this form is given depth by putting in all these little dots. It's called stippling. The closer together you put the dots, the more shadows you can create. It's very easy. Anybody can do it, even you.
This one doesn't have dots, does it? They're little lines, see? But they still give the form depth.
Of course they do. It's called hatching. Works the same way. The more lines, the more shadows. But if I wanted you to do some hatching, I would have asked you to do some hatching. But I didn't, did I?
You want me to use the dots? I mean, stippling.
So, stipple. All right, everybody, back to work. I said back to work immediately. Well, move at once, I say. Oh, how dare you disobey me? What is this? A joke?
Tracy, run!
Come back here at once!
Tracy, come on!
The guide! I can't get the drawer open!
There's no time! Run!
Guards! Close the castle gates! Hurry! Close the castle gates!
Come on, Tracy! Quick, it's closing!
Let's go before the Baroness comes after us. Do you think we're safe now?
Who cares? Without our guide, we'll never find our way out of Artscape.
What's that sound?
A drum?
Maybe the Baroness is sending a message.
Craig,
Artscape's so different.
I mean...
You're never sure what's going to happen.
Craig, there's trees following us.
Don't be silly. Who ever heard of a...
See? Every time the drum beats, there's a new tree.
Listen. The rhythm of the drum's different.
And the trees have changed, too. Big tree, two little trees. Big tree, two little trees. It's a pattern.
What happened?
Over here.
Where are we?
Tell you later. Can't stop. Repeat patterns have to be the same.
Look, the trees. They're on the screen. Craig, I recognize him. He was in the castle with us.
Jonathan Chung, pattern maker. Do you think he lives here?
finished. Wow. Terrific. One of my best.
Hi, you're Tracy. And you're Craig.
Right.
Hi.
See, I remember. Do me a favor and hang this up.
Sure.
Thanks. Thanks for getting me out of the castle. I thought I'd never see this place again. Do you want to make a pattern on my rhythm repeater?
Sure. How does it work?
Easy. You make a sound pattern, and the machine learns it and then repeats it. Try it.
Ba, 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 ba.
Fantastic. You're really great.
Thanks.
That was fun. I guess you like it here.
It's my home. I invented all these machines.
What does this one do?
It helps me to decide which patterns fit together.
I guess a pattern maker should know that.
Everybody should know that. We use patterns all the time. In our clothes, when we decorate our houses. Look, I'll show you. Now, which pattern do you like best?
They're all nice. I like the stripes.
Okay. Now let's try to find a skirt that matches. Do you think our patterns go together?
No, too many stripes. I don't like that one either. The pattern on the top clashes with the pattern on the bottom.
That looks really great.
Yeah, that's something I'd wear.
That's because the patterns balance each other. Here, try decorating this room. Keep pressing the buttons until you get the pattern you want.
Great. Looks just like a prison. There. That's better. Still too much. Let's make the middle wall plain. There.
Good. We'll keep that. Now, do the rest.
I like that one for the curtains, but let's make the sofa different. There. Wait. How's that?
What's that mean? It just means you've forgotten something.
The tablecloth. We forgot the tablecloth. There. And the lampshade. We can't forget that. It's still incomplete. Something must be wrong with the machine.
Nothing's wrong. You forgot the carpet, that's all.
Why didn't you notice the carpet? Why didn't you?
Don't worry. You are pretty good for most beginners. Most people don't realize how many things around them have patterns. Of course, I have my machines to help me. Clever, eh? And they always do what I want. Well, almost always.
What's happening?
Printing a famous painting. It always does that when I boast too much. Let's go see. There.
Broadway Boogie Woogie by Pete Mondrian. It's a pattern with geometric shapes.
Right. What does it remind you of?
A map, you know, with streets and buildings. Yeah, and lots of traffic.
That's because of the way he's repeated the squares and rectangles, especially the small ones.
I really like it. Of course, I like your stuff, too.
So do I. But how do you manage to think of so many different ideas?
Well, that's the easiest part. Turn the crank and listen.
and share. A bunch of flowers, no clear design. You better stand away from the pattern on a porcupine. There are all kinds of patterns you can compare. Is the pattern organic or is it square? Now look at this pattern, some old, some new. Perfect pattern's just for you.
Oh, depression, depression, depression. Here I am, trapped in this awful castle while those poor children wander through Artscape without the benefit of my extensive knowledge. Well, without me, there's no one to tell them about the beauty of a simple repeat pattern. Well, they'll have to go through life never knowing how easy it is to turn a repeat pattern into a half-drop repeat pattern. And if one asked them to do a simple half-drop alternating reverse pattern, oh, they'd be totally lost. Lost. Lost.
Point out a pattern in this honeycomb. Look at the paper that decorates your home. Stare at a cactus, what do you see? Look at a bunch of pipes of painted pottery. Dishes, markings on fish. Some patterns are plain with some very swish. Now here's a pattern you like, cause you can eat it too. Perfect pattern's just for you. Yahoo!
Do you collect all these things just for ideas?
Uh-huh, and I use them too. This will be a simple repeat pattern. That's always a good start.
What comes next?
I don't know. Whatever you want.
Me? But it's your pattern.
Go ahead, Tracy. Try it.
There. Your turn.
Okay.
Very clever. You're using a half-drop alternating pattern.
I am? Is that because the sponge is different from the masher?
No, it's a position. See? She dropped it halfway in between the others. And it alternates. Four, three, four, three, four.
Your turn.
You haven't left me much room.
Use your imagination.
All right.
The same as Jonathan's.
You wait.
Tricky. Very tricky.
Bet no one's thought of this one before. I think I'll call it a half drop alternating reverse pattern.
Good. That's what everyone else calls it.
Oh, guess I still have a lot to learn.
I'll teach you. You can both stay here. It'll be fun.
We'd like to, Jonathan, but we have to find our way out of Artscape.
Yeah, and without our guide, we don't even know which way to go.
I don't know either. But my traveling machine can take you to another part of Artscape. Someone there might be able to help you.
It's worth a try.
I guess so. Great.
Does this machine just take us there?
No, you'll have to travel along a pattern.
I might have known.
Not one of mine, though. It's by my favorite artist. His name's Escher, and he's really into patterns. He likes starting with one pattern and slowly changing into another, then another. You'll have to see it to believe it. And you will, because I programmed his best work, Metamorphosis, into the machine.
Okay, Jonathan. And thanks for everything.
Yeah. I'll think of you every time I see a pattern.
Good. Now start pedaling and keep your eyes open.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. I hope you find your home.
right. That was the most amazing thing I've ever seen.
Oh, yeah? Look.
Oh, where are we now?
According to my schedule, you should have been here hours ago.
Really?
You see here, Artscape tour. Tracy and Craig, right? Where's your guide?
He's trapped in the castle.
You see, we are blown off the main route and the Baroness Brickabat.
Oh, please, please, no excuses. All that matters is that you are about to enter Dexter's texture tent. A wondrous world where your senses will be set free to frolic amid the textures of the ages as you feel the fabulous fabrics your enthusiasm isn't exactly overwhelming.
You don't understand. We're lost. We don't have a guide, and no one knows how to get us out of Artscape.
Is that all? Well, just relax. T.T. Dexter will answer all your questions. But later, first, I must away inside and await those that are desirous of discovering the dazzling mysteries of my tantalizing textures. In other words, you'll have more fun inside.
Weird. Do you think he really knows how to get us back to the gallery?
Why not? He knew our names, didn't he? That's a good sign.
I guess so. I wonder what happens in here. Sounds like fun.
Maybe we should investigate.
What do you mean?
I mean, we've learned so much in Artscape already.
I guess you're right.
A bit more won't hurt us, will it?
Come on.
Mr. Dexter, we're here.
Hark! Did I hear my name being called? Hey, don't tell me, Tracy and, Craig, right?
Right.
Now, my friends, there's a word you should know, for this is T.T. Dexter's texture show. And in that one magic word, texture, lies the key to my treasure tent. Now, repeat after me, texture.
Texture.
T-E-X-T-U-R-E.
T-E-X-T-U-R-E.
Hey, that's pretty good.
Thanks.
You know, where was I?
Texture.
Yes. Now, my friends, you may ask yourselves just exactly what is...
texture?
An excellent question, which brings me to my first demonstration. A brick and a piece of silk. Do they look the same?
No.
Do they feel the same?
No.
And why? Because their surfaces have different...
textures.
Am I making myself clear?
I think so. Texture is how a surface feels.
Exactly. My vest feels bumpy. It has...
texture.
This countertop feels smooth. It has...
texture.
My hat feels rough. It has...
texture.
Which brings us to my second demonstration, for which I will need two brave volunteers from the audience. You and you. Now just put your hands in here and here, and you will feel...
Texture.
Ah, yes, but what kind?
Well, mine's smooth, like the silk, but it's hard, too, and cold on my fingers. I think it's metal. Or glass. That's it, glass!
Absolutely 100% glass. And the little lady deserves a big prize.
This is just a bunch of nuts and bolts and wire.
Oh, yes, but everything in that bag has...
texture.
Now you, sir, would you like to share your mystery with our audience?
Mine has a rough surface. It's scratchy, grainy, and bumpy. I think it's sandpaper.
Ta-da! Sandpaper! Another answer deserving of a bag of Dexter's treasures.
What did you get?
Some rice, dried peas, noodles, seeds, and lots of other different things with different textures.
Can we try guessing some more?
Well, in the absence of any additional volunteers, be my guests.
I can feel something soft and furry.
Me too. And it's warm. Hey, it moved.
It's an animal. A cat?
Uh-uh, too big for a cat. It's a lion.
That's not fair. We could have had our hands bitten off.
Nonsense. Hercules is a very well-behaved lion. Aren't you, Hercules? Well, this looks like a a good moment to move along to our next booth. Doodles!
Hercules, that wasn't very nice. I've taken off my entire arm.
What are we supposed to do with these?
Welcome to the entertainment area. This is where we entertain each other.
We do?
Well, why not? Not much point in learning about texture if you can't put your knowledge to good use. And here in Artscape, there's only one thing we consider to be good use.
Art.
Exactly. Creating art with texture. Ah, how entertaining.
But we haven't anything with texture to...
You were saying?
I think we're ready to start.
And in return, I will entertain you by singing. And believe me, you're getting the better of this deal. Now, texture can be used in art. So go ahead and start while I show you part of my treasure. Burlap, felt, and sand make a wonderland. Textures are so grand, they're my treasure. Masks made with rope, models made of soap, textures that I hope give you pleasure. Coral, shells, grass, little bits of glass, and some noodles made to measure. Use a little bit of wool. Make it beautiful. Why a teaspoonful of dried cheese. And all of this texture belongs to you with Dexter. It's my texture symphony. Aren't they artistic, Dexter's texture family?
That's really great. The way you use the wood to put them on, because the wood has a texture too.
But I like your patterns, especially the ones with the noodles.
I'm finished.
Sorry, I guess we got a bit carried away.
Happens all the time. Still, these collages are worthy additions to my collection.
What's next?
Ooh, eager little beavers, aren't we? That-a-way. Bye.
Ooh.
Pretty good. Even if I do say so myself. And I do.
I'll bet we have to make the bell ring.
We're not strong enough. It takes muscles.
Not muscles, my friends, but brains. A determined display of brain power is all that's necessary to decipher Dexter's difficult dilemma. Name three ways this burlap can be used creatively. Are you ready? Go!
Its texture's very rough, so you could use it in a collage, if you want a rough, grainy look.
And it also could be used as something.
Like what?
Well, suppose you're making a sculpture of a scarecrow, and you wanted a costume. This would be perfect.
Just one more to go.
I give up.
Wait, remember when the Baroness told us that artists have to create an illusion of real things when painting or drawing?
Yeah.
Well, if you needed some burlap in your painting, you could use this as a model.
Congratulations! You had me worried for a moment, but of course you're absolutely right. Being able to create the illusion of texture is something every artist strives for. Why, in my time, I've seen such magnificent illusions of texture that these very fingers have reached out towards the canvas to prove that my eyes were not deceiving me. But T.T. Dexter doesn't expect you to take his word for it. No, sir. Not when you can look through Dexter's spectacular spectacles.
I can paint like that someday.
Me too.
Oh, you will, you will. All it takes is practice, practice.
Practice.
Well, if you insist, step this way. The recreation area. This is where we recreate texture. What are these?
Bricks.
And this?
Blank paper.
Need I say more? Come, come. What's that?
Looks like wood.
And don't get a sliver. Why, that texture looks almost the same. How'd you do it?
Well, I put the red and brown paint on my sponge, and then I put it on the paper. It was easy.
Easy, eh? Well, never let it be said that T.T. Dexter can't provide a challenge.
Metal?
Aluminum, to be precise. Have fun. Hey, that's pretty good. I like that.
I even smudged some lines around the knothole, see? May I do another one?
Oh, nothing I like more than a willing volunteer.
Sandpaper? How am I going to recreate the texture of sandpaper?
To recreate a texture that's real. To simulate the same look, the same feel when you're drawing or painting. Try your hand at duplicating with clever illusion that causes confusion. Remember, when you're doing art, take my advice, be smart. Let it come from the heart, and you'll know just what to do.
And don't forget with Dexter and all of his texture, a knowledge really grew.
Oh, it was nothing.
A knowledge really grew.
Please, no applause. Our knowledge really grew.
Thank you for everything, Mr. Dexter.
Anytime.
We really had a lot of fun.
Yes, but you promised to show us the way back to the gallery.
I did, didn't I? Well, there's only one way to leave Artscape, and that's with the guide that brought you. You'll have to go back to the castle and get him.
But that's too dangerous.
The Baroness is very powerful.
Well, without your guide, you'll have to stay in Artscape forever.
Thank you.
blue, the primary colors. What a wonderful beginning. I can hardly wait until my castle is full of little darlings, all eager to learn about the theory of color. Ah, now to do the secondary colors. Let's see. Mix yellow and red to get orange. Perfect. Oh, maybe a little down there, too. Now, let me see. Ah, yes, I know. Blue and yellow.
We'll have to wait till she goes inside. I know. Then we can sneak in and rescue our guide.
But how? She still has the key to her desk on her belt.
We'll think of something. I wish I could see what she was painting.
Green! Such a bright color. Reminds me of fresh grass in spring. No one will be able to resist it. Now, red, blue. Violet. Oh, what a sweet color. I once knew a grand duchess by the name of Violet. Lovely lady. Oh, there. It's done. Oh, and it's so, so colorful.
Come on, now's our chance.
Craig, look.
That's awful.
No, it isn't. It really gets your attention. See how the colors stand out?
I don't mean the colors. The Baroness really doesn't have a school. She just wants children to come here so she can take them prisoner. We've got to stop her.
Let's take the sign down.
We can't do that. Then she'll get suspicious and be on her guard.
I know. Let's use her colors and mix some shades. If the color isn't so bright, it might not attract so many children.
How do we get shades?
By adding white or black, I think. Red, white. Yes, see? The red has become much lighter, almost pink.
Let's see if it works. It still looks pretty good.
Yeah, but at least it's not so bright. Come on.
So you must realize that mixing white with a color makes it lighter, like this. And mixing black with a color makes it darker, like this.
I know that already. Could we please get on with the next lesson?
The next lesson.
Thank you.
Complementary colors. Your color wheel shows you what the complementary colors are. They face each other. So green is the complement of red. Yellow is the complement of violet, and orange of blue.
Green is the complement of red, yellow is the complement of violet, and blue is the complement of orange.
Complementary colors affect each other. Watch what happens when a red is placed next to a green. Don't you think that the colors have become more vibrant, more alive? You might even see a glow where the colors meet.
I see it. I see the glow.
She left her key in the lock.
We'll have to wait till she leaves.
Oh, that's so exciting. Unless, of course, it's a trick. I mean, how can the same color change?
I repeat, complementary colors affect one another. Let's take a gray square on a violet background. Now watch how the square becomes a different shade of gray when you place it in front of a yellow background.
I still think it's a trick. And even if it isn't, why is it so important?
This knowledge is important because it means that you don't always have to mix colors to get an effect.
Enough. That will be my delivery service. I do miss the good old days when a baroness could afford servants.
Quick, the drawer.
gone.
That's what I thought. She's probably locked him up in her room with a recording machine.
What are you talking about?
Oh, Craig, don't be so dumb. Didn't you recognize his voice?
You mean?
Boy, and complementary colors are placed beside or around each other.
You're right.
Some of them seem to be coming forward, while others look as if they're receding into the background.
Come on, we'll have to go search the castle.
Wait, you see? It looks as though the colors are jumping right out at you.
Again, I must stress that the colored squares are not changing shades. Only the background is changing.
Tracy, we don't have time. We have to find him before the Baroness comes back for her keys.
She's so mean. I bet she's forcing him to make all these recordings.
Testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Let's see. Lesson number 6.
Craig, in here.
What's that noise? Is someone there?
It's Tracy and Craig. We've come to rescue you.
Rescue me?
Yes. And there isn't much time.
But I can't go yet. I'm about to record my part of the final lesson.
What?
It'll only take a moment, but I must insist on absolute silence during the recording.
But...
Please, this is the most dramatic part of the lesson. Can anyone deny the impact of color? The feeling it creates? The moods it portrays? Open your eyes and be rewarded by nature's own color wheel. Open your eyes and see a world of color.
That's wonderful.
Yes, isn't he a clever teacher? And to what do we owe the pleasure of this visit?
We came for our guide.
You can't keep him a prisoner. It's not fair.
A prisoner? I'm not a prisoner.
What?
I don't understand.
Allow me to enlighten you. After you and the others left in such a hurry, I was lonely. I had no one to talk to except our friend there. And you know what? He convinced me that I have a natural flair for color and that I should share my gift with the dear little children of Artscape. Why, you see before you the new, gentle, kind, and sweet Baroness Bric-a-Brac.
Do you mean you really are opening a school of color?
Yes.
And you didn't force our guide to record your lessons?
On the contrary, I was a most willing volunteer. But I must go now, Baroness, and help these young people leave Artscape. You'll have to finish the last lesson on color.
I will tell my students 3 different ways to use color.
3? I can only think of 1. Color describes the things we see.
I know another one. We use color as a symbol of something.
Excellent. Oh, but surely you can think of another reason for using color. Well, then, you better help me with my last lesson.
It's a warm and cozy scene. Help the love of pinks and yellows and a dash of tangerine. Now it's changed, it seems so lonely. I can tell it's feeling bad.
Nothing's changed except the colors. Blues and purples make him sad. Silver gray with darker colors. What will happen when they combine?
Eerie scenes all too creative that send shivers up your spine. Vivid red and orange flashes.
painting and please this baroness. Then you'll please this baroness. Then you'll please this baroness.
We're really sorry we can't stay at your art school, but we have to get back to the gallery.
What are all these? They weren't here before.
No, my delivery service just delivered some more of them. These are from the students that want to apply to my art school.
What's behind here?
Oh, that is my pride and joy. It's a very famous painting that I bought at an art auction. Would you like to see it?
Yes, we would.
It's a painting about a picnic, and it's by Georges Seurat. It's called Sunday Afternoon on the Island of La Grande Jatte.
I know that one. You must look very closely, for it has been created in a special way. The artist has used dots of pure color, and it is your eye that blends those dots into a picture.
You're right. The further back I stand, the more the colors blend.
It is lovely, isn't it? Oh, Craig, before you have to go, would you help me move this treasure over by my desk?
All right.
It will serve as a wonderful example for my students.
Look, there's another picture behind it. It's weird. It goes on forever.
Oh, no, not that picture. Tracy, don't go near it. Stay away.
What? What happened? Where did you go?
It's that painting. It's called The Depths of Perspective. It has the power to take you to another part of Artscape, a very complicated place where very few people want to go, and not many find their way out again.
What will we do?
Nothing. If she doesn't come back soon, you'll have to go on without her.
I won't. We can't leave her behind. We have to find her.
Craig, no, don't. Come back.
You arrived. Rather suddenly, really.
Where am I?
Here.
Here? Where's here?
Ah. That rather depends on your point of view, doesn't it, Tracy?
How did you know my name?
That was the easy part. The moment you arrived, I began an investigation. Almost immediately, I reached the conclusion that you are a young girl. Then I deduced from your name tag that you must be touring Artscape, and judging by the spots of paint on your clothing, I would say that you have been in Artscape for some time. Furthermore, in the absence of an official guide, I would say that you have become separated from your party and are now totally lost. Quite a predicament, if you don't mind my saying so.
You sound like a detective.
I am. Detective Inspector Edgar Viewpoint at your service.
That's great. You can help me find Craig. He'll be worried, and I wouldn't...
I'll try. But this part of Artscape is under the control of perspective. Very complicated and very confusing. For as you move, everything changes. I, for example, have been solving the mysteries of perspective for many years, but I have no idea where I am.
That must be terrible to be lost for so long.
Oh, my dear. One is lost only if one wants to be somewhere else and can't find a way. I want to be here. Wherever here is. You see, perspective is the only challenge left to a detective of my standing.
Hmm. It is?
Yes. For example, before you arrived, I was busily investigating all the possible directions I could take.
That couldn't have been too difficult. I can only see one.
But that's because you were looking at things from your point of view, from your perspective. Come with me. Now observe.
Look, there's another way we can go. I didn't see it before.
Of course not. But now you are looking at it from a different angle. You see, by moving, we have changed our point of view, our perspective. Let's go a little further. You see, a detective must cover all the angles.
There's another way, and another.
I told you it was confusing.
But which way shall we take?
Let's go this way.
This is supposed to be the prospective highway. Are you sure this is the right road?
I'm positive. You see, Craig, the force that took Tracy was more powerful than your jump. She'll be somewhere at the end of this road, in a place they call the depths of perspective.
It can't be far. The road ends just ahead of us.
That's impossible. The perspective highway always looks as if it's going on forever.
Well, it doesn't. It stops just at those six big shapes.
Craig, what's happening?
The shapes. They've moved apart on each side. Now I can see the road going down the middle.
Does the road seem longer than before?
Sure does. The shapes are overlapping each other, so they look farther away, too.
Just as I suspected, the overlapping shapes help our perspective by showing us how long the road is.
I'm not sure I understand.
Having trouble with perspective? Then note how these overlapping objects help the eye to determine distances. This has been a public service announcement brought to you by the Perspective Highway Patrol Information Center.
I think I have it. Overlapping objects help us get a sense of depth or distance.
Sounds like something's happening again.
Yes. The shapes at the back are moving further away. They're not overlapping anymore, and the road looks even longer.
Can you tell why the road looks longer?
Well, the shapes are all the same size, but the ones at the back look smaller, so they must be much farther away.
That makes sense. The closer an object is to our point of view, the bigger it looks.
And the farther away, the smaller. That's perspective.
And you can see this perspective in these examples. Brought to you by the Perspective Highway Patrol Information Center.
Thank you. Come on, let's start moving before something happens to make the road look even longer. Uh-oh, too late.
What is it this time?
Shadows.
Shadows?
Shadows. And here comes the message.
Shadows play a major role in determining perspective. This is the last public message from the Highway Patrol. From here on your own.
Good. Now you know about shadows.
I know it's a long way to the end of the road, too.
Want to go back?
No. We have to find Tracy. I'm not leaving Artscape without her.
Positively no doubt about it. The shapes at the back are much smaller.
Why?
Elementary. The artist wants us to see this road from her point of view. She wants to show us that the road is very long. But this is a flat surface. It does not have any depth. The artist must create the illusion of depth. She must create the right perspective. Now, how does she do it?
By making the shapes at the back smaller. In real life, even if they were the same size, they'd be smaller because they're so far away. So if she paints them smaller, it will create the illusion of depth.
Have you ever thought of being a junior detective? Pity. Let's move on to the next painting.
Wait, I saw something move.
Oh, impossible, it's only a painting.
I did, I tell you, on the road way at the back.
Nothing here.
Are you sure?
Of course. Remember, I am a fully qualified detective trained to observe every detail, and, in my opinion, your eyes are playing tricks on you. Now, on to the next painting. This painting is called Homecoming to Prince Edward Island. The artist, William Karelic, was a master at the techniques of perspective.
I'll say, it makes me feel if I'm standing right there and watching the whole thing.
The artist has painted the foreground figures very large and lifelike, but by the use of overlapping here and here, our eye begins to see depth in the picture.
And these houses look farther away because he's painted them smaller. And these other houses on the horizon, you can hardly see them at all.
Good preliminary work, but can you spot the other ways Karelic has used to give this picture perspective?
I know. The detail, see? It's very clear at the front of the picture, but as it goes further back, it becomes less and less clear, just like in real life. And look at the road. It's much wider at the front, but it narrows and narrows until it disappears into nothing.
Excellent. You have a good eye. Here. Use your good eye on this one. Cornelius Krieghoff created it. It's called Merrymaking.
It looks as if they're enjoying themselves.
It's a sleighing party at a village inn in Quebec. Now, look how he's painted the nearest people very large.
But the ones over here, they look farther away because he's painted them smaller. Oh, and look, he's used overlapping here and here, so we can see depth in the picture.
Top notch! You have all the qualities of a junior perspective detective. From now on, you must search for different ways to give your pictures perspective. You must use your eyes and your brain, along with your brushes and pens, so the illusion of depth is created. You must leave no stone unturned, no angle...
Craig!
Who?
Craig and our guide! They're inside the picture!
Oh, yes. And very lifelike. Good heavens! He's real!
How do we get them out?
Obviously, they're inside the painting, so... grab the end. This should do it.
Are you all right?
Uh-huh. Who's he?
Detective Inspector Edgar Viewpoint, and I'm his assistant.
A detective. Good. Perhaps you can help us find our way back to the main route.
Let us review the facts. Tracy arrived by being drawn into a picture that had perspective. You, Craig, tried to follow and found yourself following along a road that also turned out to be a picture that had perspective. Now, somewhere there must be a connecting link.
Pictures that have perspective.
That's it. If we came through pictures, we can get back the same way.
I've solved it. You can leave by the same method you arrived. Clever, eh? That's what I call good mystery solving.
But how will we know which picture to take? So many of them have perspective.
Why don't you draw one that shows exactly where you want to go?
Of course. That would be the place where you first began the Artscape tour.
You remember, Craig. It had Artscape written in big block letters. We can recreate it over here. Come on. If we overlap the layers and make the things at the back smaller, we'll give it perspective.
We can use shadows, too.
Shadows?
Shadows. They also give you perspective.
How did you find that out?
How does one find anything out? By simple reasoning, by searching for clues, by clever deduction...
By having a helpful guide...
By having a helpful guide...
Now, get busy and remember... To be a perspective detective, here's all you have to do to be a perspective detective.
perspective, just follow every clue. Is depth created by the size of the objects far away? Is the sense of distance aided by the way the shadows play? Do the overlapping objects help the artist to convey a sense of perspective in the painting on display? Selective perspective is when you're painting from your point of view. Effective perspective is making others see the same as you. So be a perspective detective when you start to create. So be a perspective detective and try to simulate the horizon in the distance where the earth and sky will meet. All the details in the foreground at the back become discreet. Two lines that seem to narrow on a never-ending street. And now you have perspective and your painting is complete. Selective perspective is when you're painting from your point of view. Effective perspective is making others see the same as you.
There, we finished. Now all we have to do is jump into it.
I hope this works.
It should. You've done an excellent job.
Goodbye, Inspector Viewpoint. Thank you for everything.
Yes, we've both learned an awful lot.
Matter of fact, so have I.
Ready?
What happens if we don't?
Don't even think about it. Come on.
One, two, three, jump!
In the correct place for a change. This is the Tunnel of Knowledge, the final part of your Artscape tour.
Really?
Really. Once we reach the other end of this tunnel, you'll be on your way back to the gallery.
Let's go then.
Wait. We can't go until the examiner arrives.
The examiner?
But of course, only she can guide us safely through the final test.
The final test? What's that?
A tradition. We in Artscape are proud to say that not one of our tours has ever failed this final arts quiz. Until now, that is.
What's that supposed to mean?
Oh, no offense. But since your tour was such a series of mishaps, it would be unfair to ask you difficult questions. I'll explain everything to the examiner.
Good. I like art, but I don't like tests.
I just hope the examiner will understand. She can be extremely strict at times.
I don't care how strict your mean old examiner is. We're already late, and we have to get back to the gallery before the others leave. And I wouldn't want to...
Hello, Tracy. Hello, Craig. What's all this about missing our quiz? I hope you can provide a good explanation.
Oh, hi. You see, we... Oh, unfortunately, due to my failure as a guide, Tracy and Craig were unable to follow the usual route.
We had a lot of adventures, though, and we've been all over Artscape.
I see. Well, I'm afraid this will have to go on my report, and you know what that means.
Yes.
What?
Teaching you about art was his responsibility. Now he'll lose his license to be a guide.
But that's not fair.
It wasn't his fault. And we did learn a lot.
And we can prove it.
Oh. How?
By taking the test.
Craig!
Why not? We wouldn't want him to lose his job, would we?
We'll take the test.
Good for you.
I'm deeply touched. I don't know what to say.
You'll say nothing. You know the rules. No helpful hints. Ready? This way. Your first question. How have these artists used color to create a feeling in their paintings? Let's start with this one by Vincent van Gogh.
Well, it's night, but because the blues and yellows are so vibrant, you get the feeling that it's a very bright night, that the stars are very powerful.
The blue swirls seem to make the whole sky move. I think Van Gogh wanted us to feel that the sky was more important and much more mysterious than the sleepy little town.
First-rate answers. First-rate! An excellent description of Van Gogh's Starry Night. And the other painting? It was done by James Whistler.
Well, the lady's very old and quiet and peaceful looking. She looks a little sad, too.
I think that's what the artist wanted. If he wanted her to look happy, he would have used some reds and yellows instead of blacks and grays.
You're right. The colors are very quiet. They give the painting a sort of old-fashioned feeling.
Well, that's not surprising. James Whistler painted this portrait of his mother over 100 years ago. So, your answers are very acceptable.
I agree.
Quiet! Now we come to our section on patterns.
Oh, good. We know about them.
Really? I never gave you any instruction about patterns.
Jonathan did. We met him in the forest.
Well, I hope he told you how to make patterns, because that's your next task. And you don't have very long.
What kind of pattern should we make?
I could carve something into this.
Okay, I'll do something with this.
Do you think the examiner is nice?
Yeah, but she doesn't laugh much. Do you think she's unhappy about something? Ready?
Yeah. Wait, I have an idea.
Time's up. Quite a good pattern. But it's unfinished. You should have ended here or carried on.
Like this?
I think I'm beginning to see why your tour had so many accidents. All right, full marks. But just for that, you'll get a trick question later. This way.
Wow, that's terrific. Look at the detail. He looks almost real.
I'm sure I've seen this sculpture somewhere before. On postcards.
Probably. This is one of the most famous sculptures in the world. Now, can you describe the mood he's in? And can you think of a good name for this sculpture?
Well, his mood is very still and quiet. And look at his face. He looks as if he's concentrating very hard on something.
And not something silly either. His whole body is hunched over as if he's upset that he can't find the right answer. Whatever he's thinking, it must be something very important.
If I had made this sculpture, I would call it The Thinking Man.
Close enough. The artist, Rodin, named him The Thinker.
Figures.
Now the hard part. The Thinker is a three-dimensional form because it has height, width, and depth. But how would you recreate this form on a flat surface?
Psst! Remember what the Baroness taught you.
Oh yeah, shadows. If you put in the shadows, you would highlight the places where the light falls. Then the flat surface would have an illusion of depth.
First-rate answers! Now you get another chance to create your own artwork. I'm sorry that the table's so messy, but you can throw away those things that have nothing to do with art.
What's this? Just some bits of old carpet. Throw them away.
These bits of carpet have texture. We can make a collage of them.
Very clever. And as you spotted the trick, we'll let Craig do the creating. I wonder if we'll ever know what he's thinking.
I'd like to know what you're thinking. Craig says you look very sad sometimes.
He's right.
Why?
Like everyone in Artscape, I paint and sculpt, but no matter how hard I try or how much I practice, I know I could never do something like this wonderful sculpture.
Not everyone has to be a famous artist, do they? But we all have to express ourselves in some way. Look at me. I didn't even like art before I came to Artscape. But from now on, I'm going to do lots of it. And I'm going to have loads of fun, too.
You're right. Who knows? Maybe one day you'll figure out what he's thinking.
I already have. He's trying to remember where he put his clothes.
Finished. What do you think?
It's great.
Yes, first rate. It has a sparkling holiday feel about it.
Good. Only two questions to go.
This one's on perspective. You must compare the perspective in these pictures. This one, by Claude Lorrain, is called The Embarkation of the Queen of Sheba.
The perspective's really obvious. See how far back the horizon looks? That's because the artist used overlapping on the two sides. And he's painted the background much smaller and with more hazy colors, so it looks further back.
But this one's awful. The perspective's all wrong. The water looks higher than the bridge, and the sign falls behind the trees. And this man, he looks like he's right beside the window.
Wait a minute, Tracy. Maybe it's a joke.
It is a joke, or what the artist, William Hogarth, calls a lampoon. Certainly makes you realize how important perspective is. This is a very clever joke.
How exciting. Only one more question to go, and you still have a perfect record.
This is Emily Carr's Edge of Forest. Can you explain how she created a center of interest?
What's a center of interest?
The main thing your eye looks at, I guess.
That's easy. My eyes focus on the tall, skinny tree.
Exactly. The tree is the center of interest. But why? That's the question I want answered.
Oh.
I think it's the lines, see? They all seem to point towards the tree, especially the curving ones at the top.
You're right. And the colors help, too. The contrast between the dark and the light colors direct us towards the center of interest.
And the tree is the biggest thing in the painting, and right in the middle.
So,
Emily Carr used lines, position, and color to create the center of interest.
Well, examiner, the quiz is over. What do you think of their answers now?
Yeah. How did we do?
First rate. Yes, your answers have been great. The quizzes are over. Now it's time to leave Artscape. Your art was just fine. It's fun to design. You'll have a good time now and forever. Try painting. Try drawing. Try printing. And try sculpting. Be artists together. Now it's goodbye. Remember all we've seen, and we will all try not to cry and make a scene, because we feel great, you know we can't wait, come on and create, there's no more confusion, cause we know.
our conclusion.
And it's time to say goodbye.
Art's an illusion.
And it's time to say goodbye.
There's no more confusion.
And it's time to say goodbye.
Art's an illusion.
And it's time to say goodbye.
Craig, Tracy, there you are. Nearly time to go when you haven't even looked at any of the other paintings. How do you expect to learn anything?
But we have, Miss Taylor. We've learned an awful lot.
Oh, really? Like what, for instance?
Well, we know that art is an illusion.
And artists try to create what they see and feel.
Hmm. Well, that's a first-rate observation if I've ever heard one. Yes. First-rate.
Maybe it didn't happen. Maybe Artscape is an illusion, too.
Wait a minute, Tracy. This paint isn't an illusion. And neither is this.
No, it's real. It's real!